Pray for the word God. Let's hear the word of God. Amen. Amen.
You just remain standing on your feet for a moment. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for blessing us, for keeping us, for watching over us, for protecting us, for just keeping us safe from danger, seen and unseen. Father God, we ask you right now, we come before the throne of grace as humbly as we know how. If there's anything unlike you in our lives, any unconfessed sin, any sin of omission, commission, poor disposition, we ask that you expose it, reveal it, and remove it, Father God. We need you right now to cleanse us one more time so that we can hear clearly what thus saith the Lord, Father God. We don't want any distractions. We don't want any discouragement. We don't want any reason why there should be a breach between our fellowship, between you and I, God. So we need you right now to wash the slate clean right now at this moment, God. Restore right fellowship right now so that we can hear what thus saith the Lord. Father God, we ask you in the name of Jesus to open our eyes that we may behold the wondrous things within your law. Open our ears so that we can hear what thus saith the Lord, and open our hearts so that the seed of the word that is sown today finds this ground, takes root, and brings about fruit at the appropriate time, Father God. Now let me decrease and you increase. Hide me behind the cross and speak through lips of clay. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. These things we pray in the matchless name of our Lord, Savior, Redeemer, and Friend. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You guys can be seated for a second. Praise the Lord. Thank you for, hallelujah, the warm welcome. Thank you for just setting the atmosphere through praise and worship. Just thank you for everything that was done thus far. Thank you for allowing us to witness the appreciation on display, the kind words that you gave for Dr. Wright. I like that too. Dr. Wright, I like how that sounds too. We're just so honored to be here today. I gotta get myself together. It's just taking me a second. See, I'm on. Whenever I go out and visit churches, I gotta get myself together because, like, I'm not a churchy type person. But I gotta be sure that I don't offend when I come in the door. You know, I'm used to preaching in Jordans and LeBron, seriously, and jeans and basketball shorts. So I gotta make sure that when I go out, not to offend, but I am feeling like home. So I'm going, y'all just allow me to get a little bit loose in here so that we can enjoy this day and this moment. Give an honor to God who is the ultimate finisher of my faith. I just want to get through the church protocol so that we can get into this meal. Amen. I just want to give a big shout out to my wife in the back seat. Here I go. Big shout out to my wife in the back. Well, it's all about you, babe. So, I love her. You know, you just don't know what you got until the chips are down, until you're in the middle of your battle. And, you know, I'm glad I got a woman that doesn't have the flight mentality. She has the fight mentality. You know, she's right by my side. So I'm ever so grateful. And I praise God because it's the initial connection that she made with the first lady of this house is how this all came together. So I just am so grateful I have, you know, my wife of my life, my girlfriend. I refer to her as my girlfriend. People look at me like, huh, you married? I'm like, yeah, I married my girlfriend. That's what I did. But so it's all good. House of Triumph, I thank you guys for coming out and supporting as well. Amen. I'm just so excited to have you guys with me. I love what you did making the men sit up front. I'm excited about that whole mentality, that whole mindset, because truly that is what we need. We need men. We need men to be mentors. We need men to set the model. What's your name? Yusuf, I love what you said. I love what you said. Someone trained you to go from being a boy to a man. That's awesome. Because there's a lot of 40, 50-year-old boys running around here that never got underneath someone who has a proper blueprint for manhood. So that's awesome. That's just great. I'm just grateful to be here. And one more thing, and then I'm gonna get into it. God, we're gonna have a good word because y'all, that confirmation's been flying all over here. One thing a guest pastor loves, he sit back and he listen. And I know we look spooky and mysterious, and everyone's like, "What's going on here?" No, we listen for the Holy Spirit because we don't know We faith. We walk by faith, not by sight. Well, God, you have me studying for 3 weeks, and I don't, still don't know. But then we start listening. Okay, yeah, yeah. Okay. Whew. All right. I got it. Thank you, Holy Spirit. So that's great. But I know y'all have some great times here because y'all have a man of God who is similar to me, is that your man of God is a musician. So I know y'all get stuck in worship a lot. I know y'all get stuck in worship a lot. As you're dangerous waters when your man of God can play an instrument just a little bit. You know, if you can just play a little bit, y'all will be there for a while. But once the Holy Spirit starts, you can get stuck there. Because the place of worship is such a comfortable place. It's such a wonderful place. Sometimes you just want to stay there. Just want to stay there. So I know y'all have good worship, but guess what? That's important. Because God inhabits the praises of Israel. God inhabits the worship of his people. So it's good to have a man of God who is not ashamed to press to worship, that is not too eager to be at this point, that he foregoes the necessity of setting up the proper atmosphere for breakthrough and deliverance. So I know y'all have some good time in this place. I'm going to ask you guys now, so that we can get into this message. So go with me in your Bibles to the book of waiting for the screen to catch up with me. I teach a lot of scripture. I'm gonna be nice today, let me put it that way. You know, I'll be up here on my good behavior. I have y'all flipping pages. Sometimes I go to churches and I ask them, can we just not have to stand up while we read the scripture thing going on? Because y'all be like, but we're going to get into this book of John. And it's St. John, the 21st chapter. St. John, chapter 21, verses 15 through 17. And we're going to rise for this, and then we'll be good to go. John 21. Did I give y'all John 21? 15 through 17. And it reads it thus. So when they had dined, Jesus saith unto Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? And he saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my lambs. He saith unto him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my sheep. He saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, Lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus saying unto him, Feed my sheep. The word of God is blessed. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. So, just hang with me for a second, because we're going to go someplace really good. And I'm excited that this is the day that God allowed us to fellowship, because this passage of scripture is right in line and in tune with some character and some principle that we need to develop in the house of God. And I have to preamble this by saying, if the word finds you, you know, this word should find everybody. For some, it may confirm and encourage that you're on the right path and to keep up the good work. For some, it may show you some areas of improvement that you need to work on. Don't get discouraged. Don't get mad. We all our righteousness is filthy rags. We're all still working on improving and becoming what God intended for us to be. So if the word ever finds you and it pricks your heart and it feels like, you know, pastor talking about you, don't take it that way. Don't take it that way.
Right.
Y'all can't take it that way anyway, because I'm no man, though. So if it finds you that way, just understand that God is trying to bring the gold out of you. God is trying to bring the best out of you. So he's showing you the areas of improvement that are necessary for you. So our passage is dealing with Christ and Peter. And most seasoned saints and pretty much everybody, you spend a little bit of time in church, you know about Peter. And I always find myself using Peter as one of my examples in the Bible. But we understand that this was after Christ had, you know, sacrificed himself, was resurrected. This here part of the scripture comes where Christ is interacting with Peter. And Peter was that disciple that was considered to be a part of Jesus' inner circle, along with, you know, his brother James and John. And Peter constantly proclaimed his loyalty for Christ. He constantly told everyone that he was so loyal to Christ, and he had great faith in Christ. If you remember the story about Peter, Peter was the one who believed in Jesus so much that he stepped out of the ship and he walked on water. And in the Garden of Gethsemane, when they came to arrest Jesus, it was Peter who pulled out his sword to defend Christ. So there was no doubt that Peter was loyal to Christ. And in saying that, there's also the moment where Peter denied Christ.
Right.
He denied Christ. He failed when he was pushed under pressure. He failed the loyalty test. He failed the, dare I say, the love test. And I believe that the passage of scripture that we opened with this morning is an attempt to reconcile this failure under pressure. And I want to make sure we understand that what God is really trying to minister to and the healing that he is trying to bring forth in Peter, because it is that same healing that we all can benefit from.
Amen.
It is in this reconciliation of Peter that Christ sets the expectations for love exercise. Did you hear that? It is in this reconciliation that God creates, that Christ sets the expectation for love exercise. And if this expectation for love exercise and manifested was good enough for Peter, it's good enough for all of us as well.
Amen.
Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" Peter's response was, "Yes, Lord." Jesus said, "If you love me, feed my sheep." The expectation is to feed the sheep if you love the Lord. So today, we want to establish the criteria for showing our love.
Right.
We want to establish the criteria for showing our love. And what better day than to establish the criteria for showing our love on a day that you have chosen to show appreciation and love for your pastor. In essence, to show love for your shepherd, the one who God has given charge to feed the sheep. Now, just as Jesus was the shepherd of his disciples, Pastor Wright is the shepherd of this flock. And I believe that the formula for expressing the love of the shepherd is consistent for every flock in the kingdom, whether it's over here, whether it's in the house of tribe, whether it's greater faith, whether it's at the third Episcopalian of the fifth, basilic, whatever you want to call it. It's consistent because the protocol is in the word. And all we have to do is draw from the protocol and exercise it no matter where we are. But before I go any further, I got to make sure that I'm speaking to the right sheep. John 10:27-28 reads, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." So I'm specifically addressing today the people who are following the voice of this man of God.
Amen.
Some of you came forth and said, "I follow, I love his teaching, I'm here, I'm never going to leave your side." One of y'all had the audacity to say, "I'm your problem for life." I'm going to go ahead with that. So I just want to make sure that I got the right group before I go any further. So y'all have already committed to being followers of the anointing and the call and the vision of this man's life. Now that's important. And just to start to, you know, get along the way, we need to understand that just because you don't see them in this place, pastors shepherd a lot of people.
Amen.
Pastors shepherd a lot of people. There may be people that never step into this house that your pastor has been dealing with for years.
Mm-hmm.
Whew, dealing with for years. And don't get me wrong, he probably didn't invite them out a couple of dozen times. He probably stopped asking because he knew he ain't coming. But they don't stop calling him. I love the fact that family has gotten on board, because a lot of times pastors pastor family, even though they never joined the sometimes we get things twisted and mixed up, and we need to understand this. That's why I love our pastor. I said, you know, he said universal church, but that's what we are. The church is the called out body of born again believers. It's not the people that come to your building on Sunday morning.
Amen.
It's the building. This ain't a church. We are church. We are the body. So a lot of times, pastor is shepherding people who are part of the body, not necessarily part of the ministry. Did y'all catch that? Yeah. Listen, we are not part of your ministry, but we benefit from some of the things that you bring to House of Triumph when we do outreach.
Amen.
Today, you get the benefit from the word that has been invested in me. So even though we're parts of a separate ministry, we're still all parts of the body of Christ.
Yes.
We still are parts of the body of Christ. So we need to understand that. And that's a part of where we need, where we're going to gravitate to when we understand the roles of pastor. Because sometimes sheep can be selfish.
Mm.
Oh, I don't get in trouble. Well, babe, I won't be back here. Because sometimes, no, seriously, sometimes you think, pastor, you got enough time for me. Ain't nothing but a handful of us. Man, do you know all the people that you have no idea about that we deal with? So it's a good thing to appreciate. And we need to make sure that we understand exactly how God intends for us to show love and appreciation to our leaders. And understand this, and don't ever misplace this. When you show your leader love, you show God love. You show your appreciation that you have for God for sending you a man that can reach you, a man that can get through your thick head, a man that can get beyond your stubborn ways, your disobedience, all of that.
Amen.
Because it takes a special person
right.
to be patient.
Yes.
See, y'all got insulted. It takes a special person to be patient,
yes.
to be long-suffering,
yes.
to be temperate, not to cut you off.
Amen.
Not that you dead to me, because that's how we do.
Right.
That's how we do.
Come on,
be quiet. That's why I don't get amens anyway. It doesn't faze me at all. Well, you see, Pastor, I preach what I want to preach. but amen. So let's get back on this text so I can show you exactly what's going on, this dynamic with Peter and Jesus, so that we can apply it to our lives. In our text, Jesus asked Peter the same thing three times, and each time Peter's response was the same as Christ in structure. Three times. This is important for you Bible scholars and you teachers. There is significance with the number three. Whenever you see something happening three times in the Bible, it's God trying to make a definitive statement. I'm not going to get all into the Trinity and all of that. I'm pretty sure y'all got a doctor here. I'm pretty sure he has broken that dynamic down to you. But when you're studying the Bible and you start to see threes, become spiritually conscious that God is saying something specifically. Get specific. Get your highlighter out, get your marker out, and just really dig into that thing. Get scratched beneath the surface for the deep thing. So three times, same question, three times, same answer. The number three is crazy. Jesus was tempted how many times in the day? Three times. Amen. Jesus rose on what day? Jesus' ministry was 3 years long. Jesus prayed how many times in the Garden of Gethsemane? Even in the book of Isaiah, around the sixth chapter, where it's describing the vision in heaven and the cherubim are flying around the throne of God, they say, holy, holy, holy. Three times, God is making a definitive statement about how we're supposed to express our love. This is why. And it frustrated Peter because he asked three times. But God was driving the point home, not just for Peter, but for all generations to come. How many of you got children here? Do you like to repeat yourself?
Yes.
Oh, I mean, if I have to call myself more than two times, watch this. Most of y'all got a first name, a middle name, a last name. Did you know you were in, I loved the joke, my mom said, Stephen Brian Thompson. Uh-oh. we operate out of principle and don't even know it. When your parents called you by your full name, you knew you better put down whatever you were putting down, and you need to get to where you need to be. God is making a definitive statement for the church. Jesus instructs Peter to feed his sheep. Feed. This is what Jesus wants us to do. He wants us to feed. Feed means to supply with nourishment, right? It also means to minister to gratify. This is the part I like. To provide the necessary materials for development, maintenance, or operation. So the definitive statement that Jesus was making when he told Peter three times to feed his sheep, Jesus says, Peter, I want you to provide the needed materials for the development, maintenance, and nourishment of my sheep. You love me? Provide the needed materials for the development, maintenance, and nourishment of my sheep. This is the way God desires for us to express our love toward him. Think about the life of Peter leading up to this moment. Because apparently, Peter was working under the wrong definition or criteria of love. And Jesus had to give him the guidelines so that he would not continue to fail in his trying to show his love. Think about it for a second. When Jesus was washing the disciples' feet, right? Peter was like, no, Jesus, you can't wash my feet. And then Jesus told him, if I don't wash your feet, you have no part in my kingdom. So then Peter said, not just my feet, but my whole body. Peter messes me up. Because Peter loved Jesus, but a lot of times his pride just got in his way. And because he wanted to, he was extra. He wanted to show his love, but he wanted to show his love in the way that he knew to show it, not the way that God required. Do you ever do that? We try to show people that we love them in the way we think we need to show them instead of doing the requirements. And Jesus is saying, if you love me, feed my sheep. You don't got to be all talking about, oh, no, not me. I'm not worthy. That's not what I asked you. I asked you to feed my sheep. Another time that Peter chose poorly. When Jesus was sharing with the disciples the things that he would have to go and deal with leading up to his death, burial, and resurrection, he's like, I'm going to be tortured. I'm going to be incarcerated. And Peter takes Jesus. Peter, the disciple, takes Jesus, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and rebukes him. Where did you do that at? Peter's like, no, Jesus, that'll never happen. Like Peter would say, as long as I'm around, ain't nobody locking you up, Jesus. I got this. and it wasn't that Peter didn't believe that in his heart, but he didn't understand. He didn't understand. And Jesus was like, get behind me, Satan. That was a hurt Peter feelings. He's like, get behind me. Because Peter was failing to show Jesus his love because he was trying to do it the way he thought was right instead of what Jesus required. So Jesus comes back and he's getting ready to be gone for good. He's getting ready to ascend back to the Father. But he needs to make sure that Peter understands what love looks like. And he says, feed my sheep, feed my sheep, feed my sheep. So now that we understand that the objective to showing God our love is feeding the sheep, providing the materials for growth, development, nourishment, what have you, making sure that we make sure the sheep are fed. We want to identify who becomes the beneficiary of said feeding. Okay. Who are the sheep? So Jesus told Peter to feed his sheep, his flock, the ones he had been shepherding. Amen? That's what Jesus said. So, and this is a good place to transition. We start talking about pastor and showing our love for pastor. Because Jesus said, you want me to know that you love me? Feed my sheep. You want the pastor to know that you love him? Feed the sheep. It's not that. It's the same criteria. Jesus was the shepherd. Dr. Wright is the shepherd. Feed the sheep. I got you. I got a couple more slides. We ain't done yet. I got a couple more slides. I'm like, wait, whoa there. But I want to challenge you all. I want to challenge you all to listen attentively so that you can learn how you can feed the sheep. Some of y'all already been feeding the sheep, and y'all want to see that. And to you, keep the meals coming.
Amen.
But if you haven't, find your gifting and your anointing and how you can participate in the feeding of the sheep. So what we want to do three times, since Jesus said three times to Peter, we're going to identify three sheep categories, three sheep categories that must be fed in validating our love for God. We got three.
Amen.
So the first one starts with the pastor, because Peter was a sheep. So when Jesus says, feed my sheep, number one, pastor got to make sure, you pay attention, you like this one, this is all for you. Pastor got to make sure he feed himself, right? He got to make sure he feed himself. It is important that the pastor stays strong. It is important that the pastor stays encouraged. I'm so glad that I get to come in today and minister to the pastor, because a lot of times as pastors, when we get caught ministering to that one and helping this one and going to pick this up and going to put this down and going over here, that we and sacrificing for the sheep, that we are left out. That we are left out. So for the leaders under this senior leader, what you have to understand is he needs time to feed himself.
Amen.
I heard you guys give exhortation about his teaching. What do you think? That just comes to the drop of a hat? Oh, he has to stay up. I'm not curing in my study. I don't know if you're calling me in my study, in my little room. Nobody else mind me. Because sometimes 2 o'clock in the morning, God's still talking. But we, as you know, support and structure have to understand that. And it's important that you allocate time for your man of God to feed himself.
Amen.
He's the first sheep that needs to be fed. It's the principle of responsible maturity. He can get so busy doing, there's a book called Running on Empty. There's a teacher where pastors have begun to retire and just quit, because they have no more to give.
Yeah.
Not because they don't love God the same, but it's just like they just bottom out because they haven't taken the time to nourish and refill their own tanks. So if your pastor wants to go away to a conference, y'all should try to make sure he get there.
Amen. Amen.
I don't like that. I want to go to the conference. Why pastor? Don't you understand when your pastor goes to a conference and come back better? Guess what? Everything he did, he bring to you.
Amen.
Everything he learned, he's imparting to you. But woe to the man. Don't get to the point where, man, pastor preached the same thing all the time. Because he doesn't have any time to refill his wisdom tank, because he's too busy putting out all the fires in your lives.
Amen.
So it's very important that the pastor feeds himself, because he is God's sheep.
Amen.
And in doing that, we all benefit. Anybody here ever been on a plane before? And before they take off, they do the emergency briefing. And they say, if you're sitting next to a small child, put your mask on first, then help the person next to you put their mask on. Don't you understand, if you don't take care of yourself, you can't help anybody else.
Yes.
He needs to take care of himself so that he can help you and be available to help you. So the first person that needs to be fed is your pastor.
Amen.
Pastors are first partakers of the word. It is impossible to stand up here. Hold on. It is impossible to stand under here, true man of God, with any type of conviction and understanding, and tell you to do something that I have not already been convicted about numerous times.
Amen.
Amen.
I'm not going to say it doesn't happen. That's not today's focus. But but I'm going to let you know, if you have a true man of God, he's not going to require for you to do something that he has not already done. He can't lead you that way. He can't give you the blueprint that way. You cannot follow me where I have not yet gone.
That's right.
And I'm not trying to take you someplace that I don't know how to get to.
Amen.
Amen. I'm not trying to take you someplace that I don't know how to get to. Number one, leaders must feed themselves. And leaders, just a point, love, and this ain't for this man of God, because I'm cool with this man of God. If someone's listening to this over the internet or watching it later in a DVD, this is what God really imparts to me. Love yourself within reason, not excess. Love yourself within reason, not excess. We have to be healthy for this battle. Physically, mentally, spiritually, and emotionally. Let your leader have some time to fix himself a decent natural meal, go to the gym, walk around the block, take care of himself. I've seen a lot of churches fall apart when the man of God is summoned to the throne. Amen? So the second one, second group of sheep that need to be fed, feed my sheep, is the body. Leaders, ministers, deacons, members of the church, y'all need to be fed. Now, watch this. Pastor has a responsibility. Y'all stomped all over most of my sermon, by the way. Pastor has a responsibility to take you to graze. You have a responsibility to eat and consume.
Amen.
Pastor has a responsibility to provide the spiritual sustenance for your growth and development. You have the responsibility to stop fasting from spiritual food. Y'all eat up everything else. Y'all eat up empire. Listen.
Come on.
I have no Netflix. I have no cable. I don't even know what y'all eat up anymore, television-wise. Netflix and chill and, you know, Empire was the best I could do because it'd be on my Twitter timeline. But that's all I got. But the reality is y'all eat that stuff up like candy, and y'all can't wait till the next episode. Y'all be mad when the season is over, and y'all don't know what to do with yourselves until the next season starts. But someone tells you, shun the very appearance of evil. Y'all like, I don't want that. Y'all have to stop turning y'all plate down to the things that will make you strong spiritually. Again, if you're eating up the spiritual stuff, good job. Good job. Come on, Facebook. I'm giving y'all likes and everything. No, but seriously, that's good job. But if you're not, but if the word finds you, if you like, you know, I'm not going front. My friends telling me, go get Netflix. You need to watch Luke Cage. I love superhero stuff. I'm battling in my spirit because I'm like, I can't. And this is what I told them. A couple more pastors, too. Listen to this. I said, the reason why we don't have cable and the reason why we don't have Netflix and all that stuff is, I said, because I can't afford to get sucked into that stuff and allow that stuff to distract me and start consuming my time, because I need to make sure I'm getting fed. I need to make sure that because listen, it's a sacrifice to be kingdom. And you have to make sure that you have put the proper investment of time in so that you can be effective. This says feed the sheep, but y'all gotta understand that y'all aren't just sheep, y'all are warriors. Y'all are soldiers. Y'all are in the fight. Y'all are on the battlefield. So you need to be fed, and you need to be trained, and you need to be strong, because the enemy walks about to and fro seeking whom he may devour. There is an objective against you to destroy you, to kill, steal, and destroy everything that God has ordained for you. And how you're able to combat that is through your consumption of the principles of God. Feed the sheep. When this man sets up the buffet, don't just treat the word of God as common. Watch this. Don't just treat Sunday morning at 1:05 like this is getting in the way of you seeing the Eagles. You gotta understand that whether your team wins or lose on Super Bowl Sunday, your life is in the balance for the things that happen in this place.
Yes.
This is the only thing of substance. Heaven and earth will pass away, but this right here, this feed that we're getting is supposedly going to stand through eternity. You got to understand the value of this. That's why we. That's why old church. I go to old church so long, and I was messing up because I realized old church is a good church. We talk different under the L, but we got a whole lot of old church in the like old church. Like, I came running when they said unto me. They came running because they knew there was good feed at the church.
Yes.
And after being in the world with a bunch of nonsense, a bunch of drama, he says, she says, so-and-so cussed you out, they fighting in the street, police shooting black people left around. Man, you should love to come running into the place where you got all of these words behind you going on. You got some words of praise, blessing, family, grace, love. I mean, they ain't none of that out there. Right. You dragging your feet coming to hope. Oh. If y'all hear a siren outside, you'll be quick. What's wrong with us?
Right.
What's wrong? Seriously. We need to be passionate about the plate that God is setting for us and get a palate for deliverance and breakthrough. Gotta get that appetite right. Gotta get that appetite right. Man, I could go on and on about that, but we gotta get our appetite right. My wife preached last week and she spoke about, are you even hungry? Are you even hungry? Have you been eating stuff that's unhealthy? Unhealthy so long that you believe that that's actually good food? My little guy, I mean, I probably shouldn't say this, it's gonna cost me later. You always wanna go to And I'm like, they food nasty. He's like, no, it's not. But yes, it's terrible. They have the worst of the worst. I'm like, Burger King is terrible. But he's been eating it so long that, you know, he's good with it. But that's how sin is. That's how sin is. You keep consuming it and you keep eating it, then you won't even know that you're eating poison, that you're eating condemnation, that you're consuming. And in the meantime, your spirit man is withering away. It's a slow fade. It happens rather. He said you grew up in the church and you got away from it. You were in that slow fade. You were, yeah, but thank God you didn't completely fade away, but you were able to come back and build that man up. We have to make sure that we feed the sheep.
Yes.
So number one, our leader has to feed himself so that he can be strong. Secondly, we have to consume what we're being asked. We're feeding the sheep. We have to feed the flock.
Amen.
Y'all gotta make sure y'all get that. Y'all gotta really make sure y'all get that. Y'all gotta eat this word that's being prepared for you. You think about sheep, the animals. The shepherd takes them out to graze. The sheep don't say, I don't want this grass. They just eat. The sheep don't get amongst each other and ask their opinion. What do you think about this grass over here? I don't know. They just eat it. They trust the shepherd.
Yes.
They rely on the shepherd.
Yes. Yes.
See, here's the problem. We want to eat where we want to eat, but then when the wolf comes in, oh, now we need you, shepherd.
Come on.
Y'all want the shepherd when the wolf comes, but y'all don't want to eat when he comes. The reason why I woke up is because you over there not paying attention, just meandering over into the wilderness. You ever look at the shepherd's staff? There's a reason for that hook. I'm going to tell you again, wandering sheep. All these other sheep over here, you keep wandering. I gotta leave. Everybody else don't get you because you want to be difficult. Don't you see those wolf right over here? Should let them get you. Make my job. Should let them get you. Make my job with the other 99 easier. Get on my nerves. Same old sheep, always. Same old sheep. But it's the truth. We don't question pastor when we in trouble. We run to him then.
Amen.
Let him teach on finances.
Oh.
I'm trying to get my money. Let him preach 10 minutes too long. My church got to be so long. But you study when you, but you mad when they say to be continued on Empire. It's all wrong, baby. Y'all need to get it right. You got to understand it. And in doing so, not question, because that's part of faith.
Right.
Not doing so. You show God and your pastor the honor, respect, support, and agreement.
Yes, amen.
One thing I can say that I am getting more and more comfortable with being a pastor is teaching the hard stuff. But I just don't care anymore. No, listen, it's easy to get up here and preach you happy.
Right.
It's easy. It's fun for me. It's fun for you. But then when you see the people who are suffering, and their life not changing, they're not growing, they're not developing, they're not receiving all the stuff that God says they can have, and you know part of it is your fault.
Right.
Because you just preaching them happy. I have a problem. Hey, listen, go ahead and leave, dude. If that's what you feel, because God's not going to hold it to my account.
Yes.
God's not going to hold it to my account. You can't just want the shepherd when there's trouble. Because there's a duality of a relationship between the flock and the shepherd. The shepherd provides protection. The shepherd provides medical assistance. Who do you think took care of the sheep when they got sick? Who do you think took care of the sheep if they hurt themselves? Who do you think takes care of the sheep? Make sure they have lodging. The shepherd does all of that.
Amen.
And the shepherd has to wait to get his return of investment on the sheep.
Amen.
He has to, and so the shepherd gets to shear and sell the wool, but the sheep survives. The sheep continues to grow wool back and everything. But it's unjust for you to benefit from the shepherd and the shepherd not to benefit from being the shepherd. There's supposed to be reciprocity in action. And honestly, how we do, there's no wool growing on you guys. There's no wool. The way that you make this man's heart content is when he sees you doing well.
Yes.
It's Amen. When he sees the applied scripture in your life. When he doesn't hear you say, I hear you. When he doesn't hear your amen, he sees your amen.
Amen.
When he sees your amen, because you made a decision that was rooted in something that you learned from him, that was given to him from God.
Amen.
When he says, oh, they're getting it. They're getting it. That's how you show your love. He's the sheep. So the pastor has to feed. The sheep have to feed. And then finally, when we get it together, we can feed the world.
Yeah.
I know I keep saying feed. I know that's jamming y'all up, but you got to understand Jesus is the bread of life.
Yes.
And the Great Commission was for us to go and share the good news.
Amen.
The word of God, the bread of life. This is what we are supposed to be feeding the world with. This is what we're supposed to be presenting them. And you have to understand that what we're seeking to feed isn't a natural hunger. And that's why the world is starving. Because they're trying to fill a spiritual hunger with natural, temporal stuff. You can't feed the void in your life, which results in a disconnect with God, with alcohol, with drugs, with relationships, with money, with power. All of those things, everything that I just named, has a limit. It has a cap. If you smoked every whatever it is you smoke until there was no more left on the earth, there's a limit to that.
Amen.
But God is limitless.
Yeah.
You can't fill that hole with temporal stuff. And until leaders get strong by feeding, and churches get strong by feeding, there's no way that we will be able to gather the scattered, lost out there and feed them, because they look at us. Let me spin that so that you can really get it. If I have drama in the street, what good does it do for me to come into a church with drama?
Right.
If I need deliverance and there's none happening in the house of God because we're not eating the right thing, because we're trying to fill chairs, because we're trying to get big bucks, because pastor got to have a Cadillac, not this pastor, y'all just don't understand that whole thing that goes through the church. And so I did, she looked like, pastor, need a Cadillac, actually, I wouldn't mind a pastor. But y'all get where I'm going. There's so much there's so much opinion and perception about the church out there in the street that it's, and I'm glad y'all are here because I think y'all are like, ain't none of that true. I told Pastor, I was like, man, God wants to do so much. I said, sometimes I just got two nickels to rub together. You know, but everybody be like, oh, you live this big, you don't need, you know. No, that's not that's true. That's, I don't want to get into propaganda and social engineering, good Lord. But what you have to understand is that as men of God, as leaders of God, women of God, leaders of God, as children of God, servants of God in the household, we have to be able to show them the gospel and our healthy spiritual position, because we consistently consume the gospel so that when floods and tragedy and fire and dismay comes in universal form, like a hurricane or massive layoffs or political unrest, something that affects everybody, they can say, why aren't you panicking? Amen. Why aren't you worried?
Right.
Why aren't you because my hope isn't anchored in Trump or Clinton. My hope isn't anchored in the results of Hurricane Matthew. My hope is anchored in Christ.
Yes.
Something that is eternal. Something that is, and well, how did you get so confident about that? Because I eat the right stuff. Mm. Because while y'all running around Netflix and chilling, I'm in my word. Like, what does it say about that? Or when I'm stressed out, and when we're stressed out, and y'all say, I need a drink, I'm going to go home and pray. I'm going to go home and pray. Oh, you know, there's nothing else to do. You know, maybe I'll just go out and hang with the homies. I got to get some holy homies, thank God, for some holy homies. But if I don't do that, maybe I'll just crack open the Bible and see what God is saying this day. Just doing something different, because the reality is, we need our spirit man strong so that we can survive and so that we can pull someone else in who's dying. Some people are dying out in the
streets. Yes.
They're dying. And if we're only concerned with getting a position, I really am starting to enjoy small church, little church. Like, I'm really starting to enjoy it because you work with what you got. You work with what you got. There's no big I and little you. Well, I'm the praise and worship leader, so y'all all sit there while I pray. Then we're going to try to get through this together. We're going to sing unto the Lord, and we're just going to do our best, and we're going to expect the Spirit of God to come in this place. No, I'm not the Lord of Adam. No, I'm not Diamond McCurdy. No, we're going to do, man, me and my little guy back there, I'll be on the drums at House of Triumph, and he just run around and dance and sing, but we get it.
Yes.
And we press through to, but it's so beautiful because you get beyond that whole production.
Amen.
God doesn't want a production. He just wants pure people with pure worship that are passionate about showing their love. And how do we do that? Feed the sheep.
Amen.
Feed yourselves, church. It's time to feed the sheep. There's been a famine in the kingdom for too long. There's been a famine in the kingdom for too long. And it's not because of lack of food. That's a tragedy.
Wow.
Because it's not because of a lack of food, but it's due to the lack of faith. It's due to the lack of fellowship. And it's due to the lack of forgiveness. There's some people that can't get it right because they can't forgive from past hurts. They've been hurt in the church, they've been hurt by a minister, or they've seen the church do something wrong, so they just want to label the whole church as bad. There's a lack of forgiveness, and that's why there's a famine. People can't get to the food because they won't go into the marketplace because they won't forgive someone who hurt them in the past. There's a lack of fellowship. What do I mean by lack of fellowship? Oh, you can't come over to my church and help me, and I can't come over to your church and help you. We got 100 churches going up and down Kensington. This is the first invitation I've got to any church in the neighborhood in 5 years. But when we do outreach, they come in, they see what we're doing, they check us out. So I said, y'all come by anytime. Y'all, our door's always open. Here's our information. Come on. We'd love for you to help and volunteer. There's a lack of fellowship, and that's why there's a famine in the land, because we're competing with each other.
Right.
Yeah. Pastor, right back. As soon as you're ready to baptize me, you use my pool. I told him I want to do some things for the youth. You know, we were outside doing outreach yesterday, and one thing my wife left off there. No, I'm just kidding. I forget how long ago was it? 7 years ago? 8 years ago we did the album? 7 or 8 years ago, God allowed me to do a Christian hip hop album. I did rap and I had hard hip, I do that. But he said we could do this. But along those lines, we do a lot of things for the youth where they can come in and have a, you know, something that they want to get involved with. Some of y'all may like poetry and everything. And we used to put on like just worship with that genre of music, with rappers coming in and doing Christian rap and really ministering. And I told Dr. Wright, I said, I would like to do that, but our place, I don't think it's just, oh, he's like, come on, I just give you keys. I didn't even get to tell him a vision or nothing. I didn't even tell him a split. Nah, I just need a gallery and all that. but that's fellowship. That's teamwork. That's what makes the kingdom full instead of the kingdom famine. When we begin to remove ourselves and see the greater purpose that God has for all of us working together.
Amen. Amen.
But there's a famine because we lack. We lack fellowship, we lack forgiveness, and then we lack faith. Mm-hmm. We lack faith. I'm so sick and tired of people running around talking about something. Oh, they do it after the fact. Stop it. You was calling everybody you could, and you was doing all the stuff. You was doing everything wrong, and everybody told you no, and then God did it. And you thought, oh, they do it. Where is your faith? We got to get that together if we want to kill the famine that's in the kingdom. Notice I keep saying the kingdom. There's supposed to be a famine in the world. Jesus said, the poor you'll have what you own. It's not supposed to be that in the kingdom.
Right.
He said that he came that we would have life and have it more abundantly. You see the difference? It's not supposed to be. I don't want to ask no more questions, because when I start asking questions, I get in trouble. Do you really think this is God's definition of abundance? What you have right now?
Wow.
It's feeding time, y'all. You got to do this thing the right way. It's feeding time.
Amen.
So, we need to dine together.
Yeah.
We need to dine together. But we can't dine together until we learn how to serve one another. You know, if I can't allow this man to pour into my life, or he allow me to pour into his life, because even though we come from different backgrounds and we have different ages and different upbringing, but the anointing that rests in me is the same anointing that empowers him. And if he doesn't have the faith that God can speak to me through me to him and vice versa, that's a problem.
Right.
And if we can't serve each other, if we can't serve each other here, how are we going to get it right up there? How are we going to get it right up there? Somebody has got to feed the sheep. Somebody has got to spread the good news. Somebody has got to rescue the dying. Someone's got to live the gospel. Who's going to live the gospel? Who's going to live the gospel? Mm. Who's going to live the gospel? I see one hand. Who's going to live the gospel? Amen. Somebody's got to implement the vision.
Right.
If pastor says, who's going to do this? Everybody's waiting for someone else to do it. Hmm. Who's going to implement the vision? Everybody likes to say, send me, Lord. I'll go. And when pastor says, who's going to open up the church on Sunday? I had to be. Amen. Who's going to fight the good fight?
Yes.
Think about this. Somebody has to be steadfast. Mm-hmm. Somebody has to be immovable. Someone needs to be always abounding. Someone must be the 7,000 who is not bowed down to the outer gods there. Somebody has to be, listen, so somebody has to be that one that the pastor looks to when he feels like he's beat. And I tell you, when God gave me this word, I said, oh, you're going to make me go somewhere and teach. And I was like, yeah, don't let me preach, you're going to make me go somewhere and teach. But when God gave me this word and I thought about the battlefield that we're on, it's so easy to get discouraged. It's so easy to feel like you're the only one out here that's really doing it the way that God intends for. And I'm so grateful that God connected us, because I said, oh God, oh Lord, is there anyone else? And he says, look right there. I'm telling you, man, somebody's got to be the 7,000 that has not bowed down to prosperity, that isn't just fleecing the flock, that isn't worried about filling a church full of dead bodies.
Amen.
Somebody's got to be that. So who's going to feed the sheep? Who's going to feed the sheep? Are you going to feed the sheep? Is there anybody here that's going to feed the sheep? Are you going to begin to take what you've been giving and consume it and apply it to your life so that you can get strong, so that you can exercise the wisdom? It's a shameful thing to die of starvation in a land of milk and honey. It's a shameful thing to be hungry when there is abundance waiting for you. I'm just about to, just last thought. Jesus wants to know, do you love him? That's what he asked Peter. That's what he asked us all. Do you love me? If you love me, feed my sheep. How can we say we love Jesus and we've never seen his face? But our brother who we see daily, we neglect to show them love. We neglect to show them the character of Christ. If you love Jesus, feed his sheep. Make sure your man of God is covered. Make sure your co-laborer in Christ are covered. And make sure you minister the gospel through your choices, behaviors, and decisions on display for the world to see. That is how you show God you love him. I pray that you will bless all eyes closed, every head bowed. Father God, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for just allowing us the opportunity to share the good news with your precious people, God. We ask you right now just to inspire us to be more conscious of our feeding, Father God. To be conscious of how we treat the bread of life, Father God. To be conscious of how we treat our leaders, Heavenly Father God. And most importantly, to be conscious of the example that we set before others, God. You said that we are living epistles, God. We may be the only Bible that some people read through our actions, God. We may be the only opportunity that some in the world have, Father God. Lord, allow us the opportunity to become good bread through our nurturing in the gospel. Allow us to eat from the well, Father God, that comes from our man of God. Allow us to consume that which is good, hallelujah, that will give us longevity, that will give us strength, that will give us endurance, that we can face anything that the enemy tries to place in our path, Lord. Lord, we ask you right now, just give us faith. Help us to exercise forgiveness and strengthen our fellowships so that we can bring an end to the famine in the kingdom. And our storehouses will run over with wisdom and opportunity, that the lost, the disenfranchised, the suffering, the impoverished will see the hope that resides in you. These things we pray in Jesus' master's name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.